Welcome to Mom and Mine, where we dive into all aspects of perinatal mental health and wellness related to pregnancy, birth, loss, postpartum, and new parenthood. It's so much more than postpartum depression. We raise the volume on all of these topics in the hopes that someday everyone will have the support and info that they deserve before they need it. Please note this podcast is not a replacement for treatment by a professional or professional training. Welcome to Mom and Mind. I'm your host, Dr. Kat. I'm really excited to bring this episode out. It is packed, filled with great information about medication in pregnancy and postpartum, issues around COVID and perinatal mental health and the COVID vaccines, and most importantly, giving everyone information about psychotropic medications so that they can take steps to make informed decisions for themselves. Our awesome guest is Dr. Sarah Orrick. She's a Columbia University-trained psychiatrist focusing on women's mental wellness. In addition to her expertise in general and addiction psychiatry, she is one of a few doctors with specialized training in reproductive psychiatry. She runs a private practice in which she combines the most up-to-date medical treatments with talk therapy, medication, and a whole-body complementary approach. She is passionate about teaching and regularly lectures at Cedars-Sinai Hospital, UCLA, and the Providence Hospital System, in addition to her media work. She's actively involved in advocacy work and is a member of the Board of Directors of Maternal Mental Health Now in Los Angeles. She's also going to be speaking a little bit about her personal experience of having a pregnancy and baby during COVID, which is what all new pregnant and postpartum folks are dealing with right now. So I know there's parts of this that will be both informative for you and resonate personally. So let's meet Dr. Orrick. Welcome, Dr. Orrick. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
I am so excited to talk with you and learn about what you do and how you help and support folks in the reproductive period. Can you please start us off with kind of an overview of what is reproductive psychiatry and how do you help people?
Absolutely. So reproductive psychiatry is a relatively new field in about the last 20 to 30 years of psychiatry. And it's really because we started to realize in the field of psychiatry and mental health generally that women aren't the same as men. And the reproductive life cycle of people born women really impacts their mental health. And so now we have fellowships throughout the country that's really dedicated to working with patients during the perinatal period, so during pregnancy and the postpartum, but also during other times of hormone fluctuations, including perimenopause, as well as sort of general menstrual-related issues like premenstrual dysphoric disorder. So it's really working with patients through from the beginning of menses to the end.
Oh, awesome. There are so many people who need that support, and it's interesting that you said that, you know, women are different than men, because I assume what you were alluding to is that a lot of our medical stuff is based on men and men's bodies and men's brains. And,
exactly. It really is. A lot of clinical trials are mostly exclusively on men because the reproductive life cycle and reproduction in general and menses throws a wrench in studies, is what sort of researchers used to think. And it really is a disservice to a lot of women. And this is a fantastic field. And like you, I'm also sort of subspecialized in pregnancy and postpartum. So really helping patients. And you asked what the scope of our work was. And I'm trained as a therapist and doing medication management. But a lot of my work, since there's a lot of other people doing therapy, is to really talk about the risk versus risk assessment of taking medications during pregnancy and the postpartum period. And I'm sure we'll get more into the details of that. But it's a really scary decision to make. Mm-hmm. I think it's a really complicated one during pregnancy. And I'm sort of here to navigate that with my patients and their partners.
I would love to get into that. I have a couple of clients in mind right now, actually, who are in this debate themselves. And while it's clear that there are benefits to feeling better with medication, potentially, the worry, the anxiety about taking psychotropic medication, but sometimes any medication during pregnancy or postpartum, really it adds to the anxiety and sometimes becomes its own thing. So when you say risk versus risk, can you say more about that?
Yes, absolutely. And I just want to, I think, expand a little bit on what you said, that yes, I'm going to focus on medications and I'll talk about what I mean by risk versus risk. But I think during pregnancy, there's a hypervigilance over the food that we take in, the type of exercise that we do, right? It's so much sort of getting stuck in those details that can be really anxiety provoking for so many people. Yeah. So it especially, right, if you're confused about whether to eat sushi or deli meat, like imagine what it is to take a medication, you know, that can be quite scary, especially because we hear a lot of headlines without getting the full extent of the information. So what I mean by risk versus risk when I talk to patients about this is that untreated mental health issues during pregnancy and the postpartum are in and of themselves risks. And I think sometimes we forget that and we just think about like, oh, what are the side effects of my SSRI or what could happen to my fetus if I'm taking an SSRI? But what we forget is that in the absence of that SSRI, serotonin reuptake inhibitor medications that are the most common frontline medications for anxiety and depression, we can have people that are experiencing severe anxiety or depression, which we are starting to have more data about, actually can impact our unborn child as well as our own mental health during pregnancy and in the postpartum. So we weigh the risks of what happens when you're not on medications versus the known risks of whatever medication. And I'm talking about SSRIs, serotonin reuptake inhibitors, just because they're one of the most common medications. Mm-hmm. But I treat all sorts of mental health issues throughout pregnancy and the postpartum, including bipolar disorder, anxiety disorders, addiction. And actually, you know, this is a question that we're going to start to pose about the vaccinations for COVID-19. Mm-hmm. So we really have to weigh risk versus risk. We're used to hearing risk versus benefit.
Yeah.
But I think it's important to understand that without the medications, we also face some risks.
Yeah, absolutely. When you say risk to the unborn child, I sort of hear, you know, people listening like, oh my gosh, my depression and anxiety is hurting my child. And then that having its own repercussion. You know, how do you talk to people about that the depression and anxiety carries a risk without kind of freaking them out?
Or making them feel a lot of guilt, I think is what we work with so much. I think you know. But and I think this is, I want to just kind of zoom out a little bit because we're talking about medications already. Yeah. But for mild to moderate anxiety and depression, often lifestyle changes, good psychotherapy can be enough to get us through. Mm-hmm. Indication for medications is a different conversation. And when I talk about risk, it's someone who has already exhausted some of those, what I call sort of frontline defenses for their anxiety and depression, and then are talking about medications. But, you know, I also agree that we don't want people to feel alarmed or guilt-ridden about their own mental health issues, but simply that it's important to check in with a professional to see what the best treatment plan is for them. And there are some increased data about this, about having untreated mental health issues. And what we're starting to see is, of course, there's going to be a genetic risk if you yourself have some kind of mental health issue for your unborn children. But we need more sort of small for gestational size. Mm-hmm. We're starting to see that there are some of those hormones that are going to go into through the placenta that could affect brain development. And what I mean is that the fear about medications or psychotherapy shouldn't sort of be a barrier to getting the treatment that you need, because we know when mom is well and when the birthing parent is well, you're going to have better outcomes.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for shedding a little bit more light on that. It's such a touchy subject and such a hot button issue. So just bringing these bits of clarity, I think, can really help people to even who are listening now, who might be considering medication, to help them understand that it's not, you know, you're not a scary person. Like, you're going to be
Right.
helping them figure this out, and you're working as a team.
And I think what's important, because often, because this is my specialty, I think people assume that I want everyone to be on medications, but it is such a personalized and unique decision that it's important just for us to respect everyone's autonomy making it. But also, sometimes I have people come to me and I'm like, I actually don't think you need to be on medications. Let's try these other alternatives before going to that. So it is a very unique, personalized decision. This does not mean that I think everyone should be on medications or not on medications. It's just that each of us has to make that decision for our own. But I think we need to work on this stigma around medications, especially during pregnancy. And I'm sure that you've seen some of that, the people who have been stably on a very simple medication for, you know, most of their adult life and are in therapy and have been thriving, all of a sudden become very ambivalent and confused about continuing it, even though all signs are pointing to this has been helpful for you in the past. We know that the risks are not as, so the when we weigh the risks of the medications versus the risk of untreated illness, that we're on the side of continuing the medication, it's still difficult.
Yeah. Yeah, that just made me think of a couple of clients again. I mean, it's so hard because sometimes when people become pregnant and they go to their OB, or, you know, happen to be talking to a primary care, some physicians or medical providers who maybe don't have current knowledge will just tell them to stop their medication.
Yes.
And then they're in therapy and like just hardly functioning. But are so afraid of taking a medication. And I'm like, okay, well, you're not doing so great right now.
Right. And I think a part of us wants to listen to our doctor and care so much about, and just imagine that, you know, they know it all. How could they told me to get off of this. So of course I have to follow this. And this is a lot of the work that I do, is actually educating other physicians about safety of medications. Actually, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, so SSRIs, are some of the most well-studied medications of all in pregnancy. Mm-hmm. The difficulty, as we were talking about more men being in clinical studies, is that for a long time, we've been very hesitant to include women that are pregnant in studies because of the ethical concerns of a fetus being a non-consenting participant, and sort of the variables that pregnancy brings into the picture. But what's happened is that we actually don't have that much data about any medication in pregnancy. Mm. I mean, you know, for blood pressure, for diabetes, for anything. So what we are look on in terms of for pregnancy is retrospective studies. And so this gets a little bit technical, but it basically means that we have to look at databases that keep a lot of information about their patients in terms, a lot of Scandinavian countries, of course, have socialized medical systems where this is easy to do. But we have, you know, pregnant patient A who took a specific medication during pregnancy, let's sort of look at her medical chart and see what happened. But we have the most amount of data of this type for these serotonin reuptake inhibitors, which is very reassuring. But a lot of physicians who went to medical school perhaps maybe a decade or so long ago, or just haven't been keeping up with the mental health literature, will say, let's decrease your dose or stop it immediately, without thinking about this risk versus risk assessment, and without even asking their patients, what do you take this for? How does it help you? And so what I end up doing is having to sort of combat this, reverse some of this information from my patients, and really empower them to say, actually, you know, I talked to someone who is an expert in this field, and we've agreed that it's the best idea for me to take on this medication. But I can't tell you how many times I have to negotiate these sorts of dynamics. And it's really unfortunate that that a lot of physicians aren't keeping up with the mental health literature.
It really is. And I understand. I mean, there's so many pulls on people's capacity.
Yes.
And one of which is limited time, even with limited time with each patient.
Yes.
You know, 10, 15 minutes. What are you going to get into during that time?
Right.
All this
exactly.
Other stuff?
And I
It's
think a lot of primary care doctors are very aren't well trained in mental health and sort of
sure.
don't want to go there. They're like, what do I do if my patient starts crying, right? Like
Yeah.
we don't get the sufficient training in medical school, unfortunately, to handle that. And you have some physicians that are more empathic than others. But you know what's scary about that, Kat, is that most primary care doctors are the ones treating very basic depression and anxiety. So sometimes, you know, people don't ever see a psychiatrist in their lives and can have their medication management by their primary care physicians. But sometimes, you know, during pregnancy, it's the first time a lot of people have seen a psychiatrist like me because they end up feeling really badly if they've stopped a medication and want more data. And I'm actually getting a lot of patients who are doing this proactively, which is really
That's
wonderful
great.
when they're planning a pregnancy to say, okay, what's going to happen to what I'm currently taking? Should I continue it? How do I make this decision?
Right. And I think for a lot of people, as maybe you were saying before, it's like a decision between something that's scary and something that's scary, or
Yes.
worrisome on both sides. So I imagine with all the conversations that you are having on behalf either of your clients or other patients, in either I guess obstetric settings or primary care settings, you're either talking to those providers yourself or somehow helping the patients to talk to their doctors.
Yes, so it's a combination of the two. Sometimes I have a direct line and I really like that. OBs are particularly busy, so it's hard to get a hold of them, but I've fostered some great relationships and I also work through the Providence Health System to actually train obstetricians and gynecologists about the newest evidence in pregnancy and the postpartum so they can be armed. I still think that they feel a little bit intimidated about making these decisions, but at least they're getting the newest information and doing exactly this sort of risk versus risk assessment that I do every day with my patients.
Right. Well, I know for you in particular, I think you are so especially needed because you speak two languages and you're able to advocate for just that many more people. In terms of your individual clients and, the people that you support, being able to speak Spanish to other providers or to patients who need your help, how have you seen that benefit of being able to communicate in a native language with somebody?
Oh yeah, so I grew up, both of my parents are Colombian, so I strongly identify as Latinx, and I grew up really with a lot of stigma around mental health. I was really scared to tell my mom initially that I was most interested in psychiatry in medical school because I just thought, oh man, what are they going to think? We are not, you know, I think there are some struggles with mental health issues, but growing up, I've actually seen a change in my own mother in how she used to talk about mental health as like, I mean, maybe even as a teenager, just being like, you know, you have to be strong and you have to get over it. And this is
Right.
all mental. You know, when I was down or anxious about something at school, to sort of a 180 where she's really become more educated about mental health issues. And she went on this journey, and in some ways, she thinks of herself as a mental health expert just from
Awesome.
like the experience she's had with me. But I think she initially was a little apprehensive that I had chosen this and that this was what I liked the most in medical school, but I think ended up, you know, changing some of her belief system around mental health. And so that immediately to me was a signal of like, this can happen. And I know for Latin people, it's still something that's very difficult. And throughout medical school, and especially during residency, I trained at Columbia. And so in the Washington Heights area, that's predominantly Dominican and Puerto Rican, it was really fantastic to be able to connect with those patients in a way that I think my co-residents had some difficulty with. But I know that this particular community does have, I think, even more barriers to mental health care. So I have really tried to focus in on that, both in my individual practice, where I get to see some patients in their monolingual, in their, you know, if they're monolingual Spanish speakers or bilingual speakers that are just more comfortable in Spanish. Mm-hmm. Spanish is my first language, and so it is something I feel very comfortable with. And then, of course, through my social media work, I've really been able to grow quite an audience in Spanish. And I know that there's such a hunger and thirst for that information. And it's been really exciting to be able to share a lot. And I get messages from, you know, people in South America that say this reproductive psychiatry doesn't exist here. How can I connect to mental health experts? So I think people are really hungry for the information. And once they get it, I think it really feels empowering, because the myths that were told around motherhood, especially in the Latin community, is very much of mother as martyr and of making all of the sacrifices without, and sometimes not sort of focusing on, you know, the mother and, and what her needs are. And so it's been really exciting to be able to sort of help my own community in that way.
Oh, that's fantastic. I imagine that the need is great. And being able to provide that information, specifically on social media, I think where it's really, you know, it's relatively brief, it's easy to absorb, and it's, you know, good to see both, certainly in Spanish as well.
And I think you might have this experience as well, but I feel like a lot of the work I do with my individual patients is on education. And yes, some of it is personalized to that patient, and it will, you know, I want to be really clear that our social media podcasts are wonderful education outlets, but they're not the equivalent of seeing a physician. But I do think it's sort of the opener of getting, like, you can do a lot of this work on your own. And let's say, yes, in the middle of the country somewhere, there might not be the hyper specialization there are in big cities. So you might not be able to encounter a reproductive psychiatrist. But if you're armed with this knowledge, you know, I think people are intimidated by this, but sometimes you can teach your physicians, or you can share this with your therapist and say, hey, I've heard about this. You know, have you heard about this too? Or can you tell me a little bit more about this? So I almost feel like we are doing some of the work, or we can get some movement, even if there aren't specialized people in, you know, in their specific areas.
Oh, absolutely. I definitely agree. I mean, I'm sure, you know, from sitting in so many amazing courses and conferences and whatnot, you know, we in the field get to hear all of this stuff and get that education. And I think, like, what you're doing, and by putting it out in Spanish and in English and reaching out, it really is like an extension. It's an arm out so that people can have that information, know that it's a thing and that it's available, because certainly if they don't know you exist, how do they know to get help from you? Or this kind of help in particular.
Right. And the same with this podcast, right? You're reaching so many more people than I think you probably have the bandwidth or the space to in your private practice. So it's really exciting to be able to do that.
That's great. So I think we should have you back to do an episode in Spanish about all of this information too, at a later date. So
I would love that.
Yeah, let's do that. So you were talking a little bit about COVID earlier, and now that we've been in this for, you know, close to a year globally, a lot came up in terms of COVID and pregnancy and postpartum and now the vaccine and all of that stuff. Would you mind sharing what you've seen on your end around COVID?
Yeah. So, you know, just anecdotally in my own practice, and then we have some early research that is also backing this up, but there are an increase in perinatal mood and anxiety disorders. So that simply means during pregnancy and the postpartum, we're seeing an increase in numbers, at least here in the US. And I really do think it's going to extend out into the world. This has been such a collective trauma that we've experienced. Yeah. And especially during times where we, you know, I think what we say most to our patients, you can attest to this, is like support, support, support. Mm-hmm. Get your support systems aligned, have your people, you know, come meet the baby, take time with the baby, bring you food. And that's all been changed and upended. And so I think just talking about, like, even on that basic level, right, let's not even talk about how scary it is to go to OB appointments, how scary it is right now, right, almost unimaginable to deliver in a hospital in Los Angeles where COVID patients are spilling out of the ER, basically. You know, it's a really, aside from that, right, if you just think about the support systems or who would have helped you or how you would have been able to manage, it's really, I think, changed what the what pregnancy and the postpartum looks like for a lot of people. And I do think that it contributes to a lot of anxiety and mood symptoms.
Yeah, absolutely. There's, I mean, the demand just in my own practice that I've seen for, and the need is unlike anything I've experienced before. You know, people who maybe were able to kind of cope and manage with some things, just it's so much harder now. The stress is really hard to measure. It's just so felt, and the need is great.
And we focus on the perinatal population, but you know, I think this is the next wave, right, of the pandemic is going to be the mental health impacts on everyone, from healthcare workers to people that have been isolated for nearly a year now and not seeing, you know, their friends and family.
It's hard to know how it's all going to play out over time, but certainly it sounds like you are seeing it.
Yes.
Some of the direct effects. They're both in your private practice, but also you're affiliated with hospitals.
Yes, and certainly friends that are still working in hospitals, I think, have been very impacted. And I think as a society, we will be just thinking about, you know, the mortality rates and the way that people have been dying alone without their family is just, you know, devastating.
Right. And an already anxiety-producing transition in your life for pregnancy and postpartum, now having to deal with the impacts and pressure of COVID also, and not having all of that. And I know that you recently had a baby, and
so
congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah, in the middle of all of this COVID business. So what was that like?
It was, you know, it's my first pregnancy, and so I don't have much to compare it to, except that I work with this population day in and day out for a long time now. But it was very strange. It was strange to not share it in some ways with my patients who know so much about me in some ways. And just seeing, you know, my head on the screen wasn't really an indication that I was pregnant. But similarly, just with my friends and family, you know, I felt like I was pregnant in secret, which was very bizarre. But also, I think, you know, there was so much going on in terms of loss. And I think it was really hard for me to be able to display it and enjoy it as much, just because I was thinking, you know, there's so much financial hardship, there's so much grief for loss of life, that I think I was conflicted with those feelings of being really excited about my baby. But in some ways, I think, you know, ambivalent about sharing it. And also, I myself was very anxious about going to my doctor's office, imagining, you know, whether they were staying safe, what the hospital delivery would be like. It's been really challenging. I was lucky enough to deliver in September, where things hadn't taken off so much in Los Angeles. But these last couple months have been really challenging in terms of the uptick. But even thinking about, you know, what it's like to have had close family members deliver and people waiting in the waiting room and they're going to meet the baby. And it was just so different. I mean, you know, and seeing everyone in masks, for example, and only having my husband there, it's very strange.
Right. So you don't even, you know, get to share your baby if that's what you wanted to do.
Exactly.
Right away.
And it is absolutely. And so I joke that the only people that have really seen my baby is my mom is staying with us and helping me, my husband and his pediatrician.
Oh, yeah. I know so many people can identify with that.
And it's a real sadness and a loss.
I'm so glad you said that. Not glad that that's happening, but you're 100% right. It's just, this is not certainly the pregnancy or postpartum that anybody has wanted. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of grief around this, for sure.
But it's interesting because I don't know if you've noticed this, and maybe it's just because there is an uptick in mental health concerns. So I'm also seeing it just a lot of new patients, but I think there's an uptick in pregnancies since COVID. And so I just sort of think, you know, in some ways it's sort of the reframe of like, we have to stay at home and isolate and it's sort of like the ultimate nesting. Mm-hmm. So I suppose there are different ways that you can think about it. I usually work out of my office. That's a 10-minute drive, but nevertheless, it's not in my home.
Right.
So this is different. I do get to see my child. My husband, who travels back and forth to New York, isn't doing that. And so he's able to spend more time with our baby. So there are, I think there's ways to reframe everything that's important for us to continue to think about, because, you know, the fact that my baby hasn't met his other set of grandparents, you know, is really devastating to think about. So we work on those positive reframes.
Right. And it's so hard to do because you're also having to navigate a brand new situation. It's not like you can think back like, oh, well, the last time I was in a pandemic, this is what we did.
Exactly.
There is none of that. It's so much thinking and planning, and it's just hard to have things come easy. And given that, still trying to be flexible and have the best experience possible is still the goal across the board.
Yeah, but it's been hard because it's already isolating. And I know I personally feel very isolated.
Yeah.
I'm, you know, and in some ways I feel extremely privileged that I'm able to continue to work remotely and not have to go into a hospital or a clinic right now. But I still think it's taxing to not see anyone for a long time.
Yeah, it absolutely is. All right. So speaking of COVID and how we're all coping with it, all of these vaccines, these two vaccines now have come out, and you know, there's a lot of concern in the perinatal community, pregnant and postpartum folks, about what to do and is it okay? So can you shed some light on that for us?
Yes, of course. So it's important to note that these are emergency use authorization vaccinations. And so the research, of course, was not done on pregnant women because of what we talked about. Mm-hmm. I'm hopeful that more research will include pregnant and breastfeeding people because it's so important for us to get those data points.
Yeah.
We know, though, during these trials that people did become pregnant. So there was a big myth going around the internet, and it was because there's a protein in the placenta that's similar to the spike protein. So there was some concern that these antibodies that we would produce once we got the vaccine would somehow attack this placental protein, which is not the same. That's been pretty much debunked, but it is frightening to not have as much evidence as we would like in these populations. So of course, you know, it's a very personal decision, but I think we also have to weigh that we need a certain amount of herd immunity in order for us to ever get back to some kind of normal. And then, you know, I think when thinking about this, we know that some of the biggest sort of organizations in the United States, the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, for example, have decided that this vaccine can be taken by pregnant or breastfeeding people, but it ultimately has to be their decision, one that's made with their physician. I'm very much in line with that, but I think people are so focused on what the side effects of a vaccine may be instead of focusing on the holistic picture, which is like, it's not a risk of just the vaccine side effects. It's the risk of getting COVID.
Mm-hmm.
Even though pregnant women, we know generally it doesn't pass the placenta to the fetus, but we know that when pregnant people do get COVID, they can have more severe illness that requires ventilation and ICU, as well as some risk for preterm birth with COVID illness.
Mm-hmm.
So again, I think it's important for people to view this just like we talked about the medications. It's the risk of the illness versus the risk of the treatment. We can't just sort of focus on the potential risks of the treatment without looking at the risks of the, you know, of the illness itself. And I think if you're an essential worker, if you're a frontline worker, if you're working in an ICU and you're pregnant, you know, that's going to be a really difficult, and you're constantly exposed to COVID-19. I do think it's something to strongly consider to be vaccinated. And it's been really wonderful to see examples of people in the field and healthcare workers who are pregnant and breastfeeding, you know, taking that risk.
I'm just thinking about the people who I've heard from that are worried. It's even though COVID is new and scary, for some people, it's like, well, I don't know what the vaccine's going to do. I do know what COVID's going to do. It's to some extent, not like you can predict its outcome on you
right. In
particular, but I do hear this argument kind of in general, like it's not the devil you know, because that's not a good,
right.
That's
right,
not
right,
a good
right.
analogy.
But I totally understand. And people then sort of turn around the fact that it doesn't get transmitted and that generally we don't have terrible outcomes in pregnancy, even though we've had around 60 pregnant patients die in the U.S. From COVID-19, which to me feels like too many. I mean, I think someone said, well, it's only 60. I was like, that's like one is too many, period.
Yeah.
So I think where that goes and what I really emphasize is to please get evidence-based information, get educated about what technologies these vaccines actually use, because they're not live vaccines. You don't get the illness from getting it. And, you know, I've started to go to basic biology with some of my patients. I'm like, I know you took high school biology. Where is your DNA? It's in the nucleus. Mm-hmm. This vaccine's mRNA does not get into your nucleus. It does not change your DNA in any way. And from what we know and sort of the mechanism, there is nothing that indicates that it's going to cause any fetal malformations or any concerns in that way. But of course, we're still monitoring those pregnancies. Mm-hmm. And if you can stay at home and shelter in place and not see people and not be at risk, then potentially your risk of getting COVID is very low. And you potentially can sort of go without the vaccine for a while until more data is known. So it's not to push people into any particular outcome, but it's just to sort of get informed about the decision making. Similarly, I think with all of our psychotropic medications, to not be fooled by just focusing on the side effects or potential issues that the medications might have for the fetus, but also with what untreated illness looks like for your life. So I just think about some of my patients who are diagnosed with bipolar 1 disorder. Mm-hmm. That could mean a depression where they feel suicidal or need a hospitalization, or a manic episode where they, you know, do things that are totally outside of what they would do, take more risk behaviors that could really impact their entire life. So it's something to be really cautious about in terms of making these decisions.
Right, which is more, essentially, which is the safest choice, not which one is safe.
Right, exactly.
That's really, really, really tough, just across the board, because, and maybe this, you feel this way too, and from my seat, I see so much benefit for so many people. And again, I'm with you, if it's mild to moderate, I'm not referring them out for medication evaluation, unless that's what they're requesting. So yeah, from my side, I see so much benefit when clients do take medication, and oftentimes they're like, oh my gosh, I can actually think now. Oh, I can, you know, when they're in the intensity of depression or anxiety, it's hard to imagine that you could feel better. And then when you feel better, specifically, I'm talking about people who have started medication and feel the relief, they're like, oh my gosh, why didn't I do this sooner? You know, and have this, have to kind of reconcile about how much they were suffering. It's so hard to know until you're not.
Absolutely. And I see it, as I'm sure you do, we're just, we advance so much in our therapy work. And, you know, I like to think of medication as just another tool in the toolbox. I'm very clear with people that I don't think it's the only thing that makes people feel better.
Right.
Because sometimes in the absence of therapy, it's sometimes not enough.
Yeah.
But in combination with those lifestyle choices, with sleep, with good therapy, it can really bring things together. And I agree. I think a lot of people with, you know, and I'm really talking here about the mild to moderate anxiety or depression, can certainly go through life and are resilient enough, intelligent enough to sort of bear it. But I say, like, so it's the difference between sort of having 5 pound weights in a pool versus like just taking those off with medications and just being able to like swim normally.
Right.
But, you know, a lot of people think, well, I can get through it, but it's so hard.
Right.
Why let it be so difficult because of these stigmas that we have? And this is so basic. I'm sure you've heard this before, but sometimes just circling back to like, if you had diabetes and I told you, why don't you just skip your insulin, like focus on diet and exercise, forget it. Like, I mean, you'd think I was crazy, you know? And I just think we conceptualize psychotropic medications in such a different way. I think we understand the medical indication for when someone has high blood pressure to give them a blood pressure medication, right? That just a low salt diet sometimes is not enough. And we're so careful and cautious to sort of emphasize the importance of those. But, you know, I often think people take their psychiatric medications for granted. And a lot of even physicians outside of psychiatry are like, oh, well, maybe you can do without it. And it's like, actually, this has made my life functional, or like, this is the first time in my life that I feel good. So for some reason, they're conceptualized as optional, when for a lot of people, they're really life-saving and improve their quality of life.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, thank you for bringing in all of those points. I mean, it is like both you and I are saying, medication isn't the only thing, and that's not all that we're suggesting at all. But man, when it works, it works, and the benefits that it brings is just really great. So what you're saying is there's hope that
hope.
People can feel better. How can you tell us what you've seen in terms of people feeling better?
Yeah. So what I've seen, certainly getting connected with the right treatment team, I've really seen people that I've been able to treat personally in my practice be able to sort of turn around their mood or anxiety issues and have a much better postpartum period, or be able to advocate for themselves. And then the other thing that I'm seeing, which makes me so hopeful, is social media accounts that are more reflective of the realities of pregnancy and the postpartum, not just, you know, all those like really lavish gender reveal parties and seemingly like perfect postpartum bodies, but like some of more of the raw reality, I think is really helpful in building community. I also, you know, through Postpartum Support International, a lot of different organizations, finding that there's a lot of free support groups or low-cost support groups that are accessible to people throughout the country, which has been the exciting innovation, I think, from COVID-19, unfortunately, that we've had to do so much virtually. But I am seeing that these communities are sort of growing across the country and across the world, and that is really exciting.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. We've really had to pivot and change how care is accessed, and it's expanded, I think, people and organizations' ideas of what they can offer virtually, and that it does benefit people.
Absolutely.
It's really nice to see. Yeah.
And I'm sure you've had this experience, but I know that even before COVID, I was starting to play around with some virtual visits, which were really helpful to my new moms, who are like, there's no way I can bring a 2 week old, like all of the gear, get in the car, get in the get to your office. And so we had already been trying that. And I think there's a lot of skepticism about how helpful it could be, but I do see really high quality therapy and treatment, group-based or individual-based online, which is really exciting.
Yeah, absolutely. It is. Well, Dr. Orrick, thank you so much for coming on and sharing all of your wisdom with us. And I know this is just a little bit of all that you have in your big brain and all of the stuff that you've learned along the way. I really want everyone to go and find you on social media and online. Everybody go find her. It's sarahorrickmd.com on Facebook and Instagram as well. I am looking forward, Dr. Orrick, to having you back on so we can have an episode in Spanish. And you
That's
can talk
so
about
exciting.
All of this awesomeness for some of our other listeners as well. So thank you so much for your time and being with us.
And thank you so much for everything you do and for this wonderful podcast that gets so much education out about this wonderful field that we're in.
Awesome. I'm glad to be in the field with you. so much good information in this episode. And there's still so much to know. Reproductive psychiatry is a field in and of its own. And hopefully with more and more providers being adequately trained in reproductive psychiatry, as well as all medical providers in general, people can be more aware that this is an option for them. I thank Dr. Orek for really taking the stigma out of medication and explaining it all to us in a way that's down to earth and we can really absorb and understand, because ultimately that's what we all need in order to make a decision. We need the information. So I'm really glad you guys stuck around for this, and I hope you learned something for yourself. And please do share this episode with anybody who you think could benefit. We all have a hand in reducing the stigma around perinatal mental health and the use of medications. And just by being here and listening today, you have done that. If you're new to the podcast, please do subscribe so you can get all of the episodes downloaded directly to you when they become available. And as usual, I thank you so much for being with us. Until next time. Thank you so much for joining us today. Please share this podcast. Together we can support moms and families so that no one has to deal with this alone. Come connect with us at momandmind.com.